Hi, we're looking at Luke chapter 18, 15 to 17. Let's read that passage, shall we? People were also bringing babies to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. When the disciples saw this, they rebuked them. But Jesus called the children to him and said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." Let's pray. Lord God, help us to receive your word with childlike trust, we pray. Help us to perceive it and take it to heart. Help us to be conformed to your likeness as faithful disciples, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. How do you come across as wise? Have people known to be wise surround you and impress them? How do you come across as important? Well, be busy. Show that your time is precious. Only use your effort where the effect is greatest. Don't waste it on the unimportant. So, in religious writings, wise and important men have had wise men surrounding them, recognizing them as wise, and they've used their time very precisely. It would be somewhat odd to surround yourself with the unimportant, the insignificant. And what better example in the ancient world of the unimportant and insignificant could there be than children? Too young to pay their way, to make a contribution, to be wise. So how are they going to make you seem wise? All they're going to do is sap time that you could surely use better. The disciples seem to be on board with that way of thinking, and they're convinced that Jesus is being unwise. He's taking on too much. After all, there are only 24 hours in the day, and he's wasting those. Or maybe it's more subtle than that. They're pitying Jesus. After all, he's a lovely guy. He just doesn't know how to say no. And here are these pesky parents bringing these little children to him one after the other. It's a waste of his time and energy. We'll sort it out, they think. We'll triage his visitors. Don't worry, we'll let the important ones through. Not a problem. The people who need to get to Jesus. But the time wasters, the insignificant, the unimportant, well, we'll just turn them back. Now, the disciples aren't setting out to be mean. They're wanting to protect Jesus. And so that's exactly what they do. Here come more children. Now, the NIV translates it as babies. The word is brephon, which suggests a younger child than the normal pedion, but it doesn't necessarily mean they can't walk or talk. In fact, in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, the word is used for the age when Timothy was first able to understand the scriptures. So these are young children, but they're probably walking and talking. Nevertheless, they've been brought to Jesus. They aren't old enough to go trekking around the countryside on their own. They aren't old enough to have a job or be able to look after themselves. These are little children. And they're coming to Jesus, and the disciples see them coming and they rebuke them. They tell them off. Who do you think you are? Well, perhaps the children, perhaps the people bringing the children are the ones who are rebuked, but the upshot is the same. The children are stood there either being told off or hearing the grown-ups responsible for them being told off. And for what? For daring to approach Jesus. That image is going to stick. But then a voice is heard over the disciples, the voice of Jesus, who calls the little children to him. And Jesus gives the disciples a command. He says it, and then he says it from the opposite direction to make sure it's sunk in. Verse 16, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them." Jesus links up those acts. To rebuke these little children from coming to Jesus is to hinder them. I wonder how we rebuke or hinder children from coming to Christ. speaking as a parent, it's a scary thought to think that my actions might hinder my children, even as they attempt to come to Christ. But it's so easy to do. It's so easy to tell the children off for making a noise in the service, as though Jesus commanded them to be silent. It's so easy to tell them off for sitting in the wrong place, or not quite behaving the way that I expect them to. So easy to expect them to be miniature adults instead of children. So easy to treat them as though they're less important because of their age, less worthy of solid biblical teaching. It's one of the reasons that we provide the mustard seed material week in and week out, because I spent some years myself in a church where Sunday school consisted entirely of a sheet of blank sugar paper and some blunt, dry felt tips. How do we rebuke and or hinder children from coming to Christ? How do we triage the path to Jesus or set up roadblocks in the way? We need to pray and repent of our sinfulness and ask God's help to lower those man-made barriers. Now, of course, while the children form the basis of the account, this account is about more than encouraging simply children to come to Christ. The clue is in the word, such as these. Yes, Jesus wants the little children to come to him. When we point children to this passage and remind them that God welcomes them just as much as he welcomes anyone else, that he values them and invites them to know him and know his salvation just as much as anyone else, then we're doing a great thing. But Jesus is talking to the disciples here, and he's challenging them. And he's challenging them to look at themselves and their own faith and to look at their attitudes to others. Put it another way, their discipleship and their evangelism. And we do well to do the same. Let's start with our discipleship, our own walk with Jesus. You see, true faith consists of childlike dependence on Christ. This is discipleship. Notice that when Jesus rebukes the disciples, he doesn't say that the children might not be saved. In verse 17, in fact, he warns that any who aren't childlike in their faith will miss out. And right now, as the disciples try to shape Jesus's agenda, they're not trusting him. They're not being dependent on him and his wisdom. What's the implication? Well, the kingdom of heaven will not belong to them if they will not humble themselves before Jesus. And that would be a great tragedy, because the gospel message is so simple. It boils down to this: you're welcome. You're welcome if you will only trust Jesus, depend on him, rely on him, trust that when he says he can save you, he can save you, and therefore repent your sins to him. A child doesn't ask where the next meal is coming from. They don't ask how the gas bill's going to be paid or whether they'll have a roof over their head. Nor do they ask why their parent forgives them when they've done something wrong and their parent forgives them. We're called to have that same childlike dependence on Christ, to accept that he welcomes us, that he offers us forgiveness, that he has sufficient capacity to both welcome us and forgive us in the full knowledge of our past and of our present. Now, of course, in reality, Jesus has abundant capacity to welcome us into his family. So again, you're welcome. Simply trust Jesus. But that means that we need to stop with the excuses. Oh, Jesus can cope with that, but this part of my life, that I'm going to hang on to. That's not childlike. Or perhaps Jesus is great on Sunday, but once I'm in the office on Monday, it all gets a bit more technical. Jesus might be better off if I dealt with that a bit. Or maybe it's my life gets pretty messy at times, So I'll cordon this bit off. I'm grateful for Jesus' forgiveness and I live for him in this area of my life, but that bit's a bit messy. Jesus should just keep out of that bit. No. Jesus says, I'm your saviour. I'm your almighty God. I'm the creator of all things seen and unseen, including you and the street you live in. I've died and risen again for the salvation of sins. Trust me, he says. My shoulders are big enough. So, in our discipleship, our walk with Christ, Jesus says, stop making excuses. Put yourself in my hands. You're welcome. Did you spot that the reason the people were bringing their children to Jesus was so that he could lay hands on them? Now, of course, that has the meaning of beating someone up now, doesn't it? That's not what we're talking about here. This is the blessing that people sought out from rabbis and elders for atonement. It was asking for sins to be forgiven, for a blessing from God. And here is Jesus inviting these children to know atonement, to know being made one with God, being blessed, being declared righteous by being forgiven for sins. What a wonderful thing to be at one with God. Why not renew that commitment to him today, to place yourself in Jesus' hands, to trust him completely for salvation and in every part of your life? But as we've already heard, what Jesus is saying impacts more than my personal relationship with Jesus, as important as that up. That is, it impacts more than my discipleship on its own. It impacts the effect that I have on others as well. So, as well as talking about discipleship, let's talk about evangelism. That is spreading rather than hindering the good news as it goes into the world. Evangelism. Perhaps put it like this: Jesus welcomes all, so should we. The kingdom of God belongs to such as these, says Jesus, as he welcomes in the children, the vulnerable, the powerless, the dependent. And yet when we set out to evangelize, we so often begin with a quick calculation in our head. Is that person worth it? If it's in the workplace, we wonder what the fallout will be if they refuse the gospel. Or we think about whether we like them enough to want them to suddenly pitch up at church. Do they justify our effort? It's a short step from there to, well, isn't Jesus a bit busy anyway? Doesn't he have plenty of people he's saving already? But the kingdom of heaven belongs to such people as these, says Jesus. Such people as those who will respond to his message of grace and mercy, who will accept his gift of salvation. The kingdom of heaven belongs to such people just as much as it belongs to us. So don't hinder. Don't rebuke. Don't stand in the way. Of course, standing in the way could take the form of actively pushing somebody away, or it could be more like refusing to share the PIN code to open the door to the kingdom of heaven. Or even staying silent as the person stands at the door typing in codes frantically to get in. Even staying quiet and not even mentioning that on the other side of that door is eternity with Christ. How would they know they wanted to go through it? Without mentioning that here is amazing forgiveness and mercy and grace, and it belongs to them. If only they'll trust in him. Make no mistake, we can hinder people coming to Christ by passively ignoring them, by quietly not bothering to share Christ, by deciding that they or us or Jesus are too busy. It doesn't really matter what the excuse is that we use. Jesus' instruction to us is exactly the same. Let them come to me and don't hinder them. Don't withhold my love from them. Don't keep quiet about my grace, my mercy, my love, my sacrifice. Do not hinder them. Don't triage them out of the line or set up a roadblock to check who should get through. Don't do anything that would falsely represent my welcome to all who would repent and believe. Christ died for them, just as he died for you and for me. Brothers and sisters, I firmly believe that if we take this seriously, it's going to change our week. Who should you be sharing the gospel with? Who should you be sharing the gospel with? No excuses. Let's prayerfully get on with it. And with that, let me pray. Dear Lord, we confess that all too often we do make excuses. We do shy away from sharing your gospel. We undervalue the importance of your gospel. We claim it for our own with joy and then treat it as though it's rubbish when we interact with others. Lord, we confess that we become overcome with fear about losing relationships with those that we love as we share your gospel. We confess concern that, Lord, we might damage friendships or push people away, and that these things override your gospel mandate, that they override the importance of sharing Christ. Lord, forgive us. Lord, we don't want to rush in like bulls in china shops, but Lord, we pray that you would give us grace and compassion and the right words to say that will share your gospel clearly. Lord, we pray that you would grant us this courage by your Holy Spirit, and we thank you that you have promised to be with us even to the end of the age, that as we go out to share you, you go with us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, as always, do like and subscribe on our YouTube channel because it helps us to share the gospel with more people. And I pray that God will bless you as you go out from this video, that he would give you opportunities, you would see those opportunities and you would grasp them with a full sense of joy at the wonder of Christ. So every blessing this week. God bless you. Bye.